have there your 50 meals, and after that we can discuss with you part of your presentation.
Well, first good morning for everyone, and thanks for coming to our symposium. As Vinicius said, PG student at Brazil in the Federal University of São Carlos. I do the political science, and I'm here at King's this semester as part of my, we say in Brazil, sanduíche, a period that we stay at a foreign university. Okay. Anyhow, first question that I have when I talk about Anglo-Brazilian Anglo relations, especially this period, is why 22 to 77? This period is a period where the United States was a big influence in the Brazilian life. Okay, 22 is the year that the American Aero Mission came to Brazil to help the Brazilian Navy to modernize itself. And 77 is the year that President Geisel canceled the military accords with the United States. So it's two big marks in Brazilian naval history. Okay? So what are what is the objective of my research? It's mainly to understand the Anglo-Brazilian naval relations under the context of the foreign policy of both countries, both Brazil and both UK, during the period of US hegemony over naval matters in the Brazilian Navy. Okay. I have a hypothesis that during this period you have a different patterns of naval relations. The first one between the coming of the American naval mission to the entrance of Brazil in the World War II is a period where the US and Great Britain, they dispute influence over Brazilian Navy. They are equals fighting for the influence for the sales of weapons, training, and the organization to Brazilian Navy. And after Brazilian entrance in the World War II with the Allied side, especially the United States, the US becomes a dominant force and practically establishes a hegemony over Brazilian Navy. And Britain takes a more opportunistic and commercial approach when dealing with Brazilians. They search for the opportunities that have in the hegemony of the Americans in Brazilian Navy. Okay. In this work, I mainly talk about the naval sales. Naval sales of especially major warships. Okay. So technology is a very important issue in my work. And considering that, I have to came back a little to talk about naval technology and the change since the 19th century. Okay. During the last quarter of the 19th century especially, and the first quarter of the 20th century, naval technology passed through a revolutionary change. Everything changed. How you build ships, how big they are, what are their weapons, how you fought. Okay, I like very much this two comparison image because it shows the big transformation of the spirit clearly. the difference between these two ships, the Temerai and the Texas, are just 100 years. This is the warship from the start of the 19th century, and this is the one warship from the end of the 19th century. So, as you can see, there's a lot of change. But what this change means to a country like Brazil? First of all, means that Brazil, as a country that had not been industrialized at that time, could not build a modern warship. Okay. If Brazil could not build and develop modern technology, it depends on imports to have a modern fleet. And this introduces the question of the dependence of Brazil on imports. Okay? Evidently, when we talk about dependence, we talk about armed transfers. And armed transfers have important political factors involved in them. Okay, even more if you consider weapon system so visual and impressive as one warship. Okay, one of my approaches is to understand the arms transfers and sales as a tool of foreign policy. The suppliers of warships to Brazil use those sales to gain a share of influence of Brazil and support to their policies. This relationship is not on one hand, it's not just the foreign powers trying to get Brazilian support. It's both ways. Brazil uses the foreign sales and transfers also to gain political importance, to gain to advance their his interests. Okay. Other important thing that I stress in this work is the idea of naval diplomacy. And when I talk of naval diplomacy here, I'm not talking exactly about gunboat diplomacy. I'm talking about naval diplomacy in the perspective of CANMOVE, that you can use almost any naval means as a tool of diplomacy, including the naval aid. Naval aid can be naval missions, can be transfers of warships, can be sweeping ports from naval mines. Can be almost any activity related to naval defense. Okay? Although I'm a political scientist, I very like much the history. And I always take it back to explain the moments there. Well, Anglo-Brazilian naval relations are very long-lasting. They became, probably, even before Brazil was an independent country. The first image is the coming of the Portuguese royal family to Brazil. It's important to note that British warships escorted the Portuguese war fleet, the Portuguese royal family to Brazil. So you can say that the relations start even at this moment. After Brazil became independent, Brazil had a problem because it had no navy. And almost all the captains, admirals, and sailors were Portuguese. So you didn't have enough trust in them to guarantee that they will fight their countrymen to the independence of Brazil. The solution founded was to hire mercenaries. And in naval aspect, the main mercenaries were British. Okay, here's Lord Crowshank. I don't know if I speak his name exactly correct, but anyway, he was one of the first commanders of Brazilian Navy. He fought the Portuguese in Brazilian side. He also fought in the Greek War of Independence and Chile War of Independence. He fought him. This British element in Brazilian Navy was very strong in the first half of the 19th century. Many of the wars that Brazil fought in that time were with warships manned with British sailors, officials, and captains. There's a British author that states that Brazilian-Argentina war over Uruguay was actually a war between British men, because both navies have almost completed commanded by British officials. Okay, here is the image of one of the naval battles between Brazil and Argentina in the war against Uruguay. Okay, when the Industrial Revolution began to change the shipbuilding, how the warships are made, and Brazil couldn't continue to produce modern warships, started importing. And Britain, as not just the main naval power in the world, but also in that moment the main industrial power in the world, was the logical supplier. And from the 1850s forward, Brazil started to buy British warships. Okay? Here are some examples in the 19th century. Here's the frigate Amazonas. It was an ironclad battleship used in, against the Argentinians in the war against Rosas e Uribe. The monitor Colombo used against the Paraguayans in the War of Fragatas, and the battleship Riachuelo that was bought in the late 19th century. Okay, so the relationship between Brazil, the naval relations between Brazil and Britain, that in the first moment were mainly of hiring mercenaries and as example for organizing itself, became a one of supplier and receiver of warships. This relationship advanced and came to the peak in the start of the 20th century, when Brazil bought an entire new battlefield fleet with modern dreadnoughts, a warship that in that moment just British, just the British Navy had, and Brazil bought in that moment, at that very moment, the two more powerful warships in the world for a little time. This was this big ship, the Minas Gerais class Dragon. Okay, in that time, the Brazilian fleet was almost entirely built in British yards, with few exceptions, was mainly British. Obviously, the influence of the British was not felt only in the material, but also in the how you organize the Navy, how you think strategically and tactically. Okay? But this relation started to change with the Great War. Britain was committed itself to defeat Germany, change their focus on the exporting warships to Latin America to produce for themselves to fight the Germans. Okay? So in this process, the British interests in Latin America that were immense in the period before the war lose importance, lose priority. And at the same time, the United States emerge as the major influence on the region. Okay? In naval matters, what this means? First of all, means that the United States will become progressively more present with Brazilian Navy. The start of the Brazil-US naval relations, I think that is in 1940, that when a naval officer of the US Navy was sent to Brazil to teach in the recently created Escola de Guerra Naval. Maybe the Brazilian officers here could talk about better this topic, but anyway. When Brazil enters in World War I, they realized that the Brazilian Navy was in a terrible shape. The warships were incapable even of going to high seas. They have a poor man and maintenance. They were poor men. There was a terrible training. To Brazil participate in the war, you have to call for help. And that time, the US and the British offered help to Brazil. They sent naval officers to train Brazilians to prepare them for fighting a modern war that Brazil in that time had no idea of how to fall. Okay, this organization have a significant success considering the poor state of the Brazilian Navy at that time, and Brazil sent a task force, a naval task force, to European waters in the very end of the war. Actually, the Brazilian warships came just a few days before the armistice. But anyway, they came. Another important change in this moment is that the efforts of Brazil to become more proficient at sea was the involvement of Brazilian officers in US warships to learn how they organize the ship, how they make everything to work. These Brazilian officers that have gone to the US warships became an important pro-US faction within the Navy. That in that moment was still dominated by the British influence. Okay. In the post-war period, the poor shape of the Brazilian Navy in the World War I shows that Brazil needs to modernize its Navy immediately. And this is a need not just for Brazil, but for South American countries in general. Although they had bought modern war fleets 10 years before, the technological change of the war and the poor shape of the navies for lack of training and even preparation to handle these warships made it that the South American navies were very obsolete by that moment. And the solution found it was to call for help. One of the first actions was to refit the Brazilian dreadnoughts, the Brazilian battleships. Again, the US and Britain tried and offered to help, and the US won this round. Okay, and the President Reynolds were refitted in New York. In 22, over the discussion about who would supply the NAVO mission, the Americans won again and they sent. Here is the Brazilian battleships being after they were modernized, and here is the first head of the American naval mission, Captain Volschesgen, I think. Anyway, the initiative of the Brazil to modernize its fleet does not advance during the 20s, mainly for political and economic problems that occurred in that time. The only advances of the Brazilian Navy is a defeat of the cruisers, pre-war cruisers, and they buy one British destroyer, but it was not a real, really a negotiation with Great Britain, because it was a used destroyer that a Brazilian company had, and one submarine from Italy. Okay. So the naval relations between Brazil and Britain do not advance in that time. Here's the Maranhão, the destroyer, the British destroyer that Brazil bought. The things start to change with the ascension of the Vargas presidency. And he was determined, for many reasons that I will not talk here, to modernize the Brazilian Navy. Okay? He was committed with that. In the first moment, the American influence have an impact because of the U.S. support for the previous regime in Brazil. The U.S. Supported what President Washington Luiz when Getúlio Vargas fought against him in the Revolution of 30. So, as a response, Vargas canceled the American naval mission for a little period. But it was important to give hopes that Britain would help and recover their influence. In that moment, Brazil wanted cruisers, destroyers, submarines, and mine sweepers. The Navy was practically disarmed in that moment. Just battleships had some significance in that moment. Many countries became interested in the Brazilian naval project. Here is the four more important: Great Britain, United States, Italy, and Germany. As you can imagine, these countries were disputing the international context in the building of the alliances that were fought in the World War II. So the question to supply warships to Brazil was not just a confrontation between rival commercial perspectives, was a confrontation of the Brazilian position in the international context. If Brazil would join the Allies or Brazil would join the Axis, was a very important. Great Britain and the United States had a problem in supplying Brazil with warships at that moment. That were the international treaties that forbade the sales and the building of major warships. So Brazil tried to acquire cruisers in the United States and Great Britain without success because they were forbidden by these treaties. And on the other hand, the United States, although thought Brazil was a central piece in their policy to Latin America and to build a unity within the Western Hemisphere against the Germans, facing legislative barriers in supplying warships to Brazil. The United States was deeply involved in the isolationist policy that moment that forbade the President Roosevelt to sell warships to Brazil. Here's him with Getúlio Vargas. This created tensions. If the US were very friendly to Brazil because it wants Brazil at its side, it could not supply warships to Brazil, Britain gains their share. And you have a relative success in that moment. The British sell 6 destroyers to Brazil, the Javali class in Brazilian Navy, in the late 30s. However, the war started. And those destroyers were not already to be delivered. Okay? With the start of the war, the first thing is that Latin America again loses importance to Britain because British resources must be used to the war effort. And this means that Britain would not deliver the Brazilian destroyers. They take for them the indemnization to Brazilians and took the Brazilian destroyers being built there. And at the same time, Latin America became more and more important in that context, Brazil even more, to the United States, in the way that you have to create a hemispheric system of defense that would guarantee the security of the United States. So, in one side, Britain at that moment were incapable of helping Brazil, and the United States, because of the war, became the only country that was capable of helping Brazilians, because in the Axis side, they were blocked by the British Navy. Okay? And between 1939 and 1942, Brazil and the US made a very tough negotiation from the Brazilian entrance in the American side. And one important issue in that was the supply of weapons to Brazil. Okay? Between 1942 and 1945, Brazil participated in the war, was completely modernized under American leadership to become an anti-submarine force that was capable to deal with the German submarine menace. Okay? The Americans were a major impact on this modernization. They made a major impact in the modernization. And everything in the Brazilian Navy became in the standards of the US Navy. Okay? I'm talking about organization, strategic thinking, tactics, naval means, the warships. Everything was American or influenced by the Americans. Okay? As a big example of that, during the war, 24 warships were transferred to Brazil for no costs, including destroyers and submarine chasers. This one was the warships transported. However, the conditions changed in the post-war period. If the Americans had Brazil as ultimate most important partner in Latin America, after the war, Latin America loses priority. And Brazil does not receive the warships that she wanted. Okay? However, the relations remain very close. In this context, Brazilian Navy saw the help of the Americans very well and decided to continue with this close relationship. Okay? And became a force with a focus on anti-submarine warfare within the context of the emerging Cold War. And in this point, it's important to stress the military deployment that transferred warships and spare parts to Brazil for almost no cost at all. Okay. In the British side, the demand of the war made the economy in a poor shape. And Britain needed the financial resource to rebuild the country. And so the traditional arms market in Latin America as an excellent way to gain resources. Okay. However, the US was against British interest in arms sales in Latin America because they were engaged in a program of standardization of the armed forces in Latin America in a way that they could maintain hegemony of the armed forces of Latin America and establish a military doctrine and thinking that would make them united against an extracontinental menace, in that case, the Soviet Union. However, but the British did not give up. They tried to regain. The problem of them was regain a part of their share in the arms market without creating conflicts with the United States. It was a dubious relationship in that point. After that, Brazilian foreign policy became progressively more dependent of the United States. And this reflected in the naval procurement process of Brazil. Okay. One of the main issues was the United States' refusal to transfer modern and prestigious warships to Brazil. Brazil saw itself as the preferential ally of the United States in Latin America and wanted to be treated that way. This means that Brazil wanted big warships, not necessarily related with the anti-submarine warfare, that shows the leadership that Brazil hoped to exercise in Latin America, siding with the United States. The Americans, however, were not interested with that. Not only did they have to take their resources to more hot areas, more hot in the Cold War scenario, but also they have a problem that if they gave too much warships to Brazil, it would create a conflict with Argentina and Chile that were the main rivals of Brazil in the political leadership in that region. And this it would create a tension within the hemispheric bloc that the United States was constructing in Latin America. This refusal created some military faction, especially in the case of the cruisers. Brazil was trying to get cruisers since the 30s and got two in the start of the 50s, two American cruisers transferred. However, both the Chileans and the Argentinians received also two. And to Brazilian political and military leadership, that was an impact because they felt betrayed. The Argentina in that moment was under the Perón government, trying to be more independent than the United States and received the same resources that Brazil. Okay. If Brazil didn't have the means from the Americas, they searched for new old markets. especially United Kingdom, Netherlands, Japan, and France. The main interest in that time was in modern destroyers and an aircraft carrier. And Brazil bought in 1956 a British carrier the Vengeance, and renamed it in Minas Gerais. Okay. However, this naval relationship did not evolve. The carrier was refitted in a Dutch port and received, in fact, American planes. So the British barely sailed a second-hand aircraft carrier. The carrier for this was incorporated as an anti-submarine carrier didn't have any major impact in the Brazilian strategy at that time. It was a big prestigious ship, but did not change the focus of Brazilian Navy at that time. However, the looking of Brazil to other markets made the Americans worried about their transfers, and then sent to Brazil more second-hand destroyers, submarines, and minesweepers and under the MFP. In 64, the new Brazilian regime became initially more close to the United States under the rhetoric of the anti-communism. Okay. In the first moment, you will have closer relations. However, there was a big change in that moment in the patterns of arms transfer. In the 60s, Latin America was under influence of the consequence of the Cuban Revolution. The second effects of the Vietnam War. That showed to the Americas that the main problem to Latin America was not really create a defensive barrier against Soviet Union for the external defense, but was an internal defense, was an anti-insurgence perspective. And the transfers of arms from the U.S. changed in that way. The Americans started to deliver all anti-guerrilla armaments that were much more cheaper, but were not very fit for external defense. Okay. In 1967, Brazil approved an ambitious program to modernize its fleet, the Programa Nacional de Renovação dos Meios Flutuantes, that sought to buy many warships in that moment. Initially, Brazilians looked for the Americans. However, the Americans were not really intent of delivering these weapons to Brazil. So the Brazilians, in a moment that coincides with a turn for a more independent position from the government Costa e Silva, goes to look to the European market. The UK was a main actor there.
Sorry, Rudolf, I ask you to run to the conclusion because you have your time already.
The United Kingdom was very interested in the Brazilian warship naval program because the decolonization process reduced the Royal Navy in size, and this means that the industry had a bigger dependence on foreign sales. Okay? There was political interest also in that, economic difficulties in the shipbuilding industry, and combined with the Latin American interest in new weapons, advanced weapons. Okay, UK and Germany, West Germany, try to supply warships to Brazil, but this time the United Kingdom won the competition. Used mainly Royal Navy visits, warships visits to Brazilian ports, used the historical relations between the two navies, and used an important perspective that the Royal Navy was a small, modern, and capable warfleet, more cheaper than the one proposed by the American standards. So you have a very successful sale, 6 frigates, the Niterói, that was in that time the biggest arms sales ever in the history of United Kingdom, and 3 submarines from UK. Okay. The fact that the Niterói frigates was were very, very important for Brazilian Navy, had a big meaning a technological leap for the Brazilian Navy. 2 of them were built in Brazil and increased the shipbuilding capabilities in Brazil, that was important. They reduced the dependence on the United States, and that time did not have much impact in naval strategy because they were and submarine warships. However, this new, renewed, strong relationship did not last long. Why? Because competition came in new forms. The United States canceled some restrictions and sell second-hand warships, and West Germany offered a new approach to Brazilians, offering a transfer of advanced technology. That was what Brazilians wanted most. Okay. Basically, is that I try to stress the importance and the relations between foreign relations and arms transfers in naval sense, and show the 2 patterns of this relationship during the American hegemony. Over. Apologize for being finishing later, but anyway, it's that. Thank you.
Thank you. So, you have questions? We still have some minutes for it. I think you did that to avoid the questions, no?
Yeah. Also, we'll let you run for BAE Systems. Thank you for your presentation, it was really interesting. And actually, I think there are still some themes there that we see today, particularly naval strategy and the way that Brazilians are approaching their equipment acquisitions. I'd be interested to know what your thoughts are on, obviously there's a high reliance on partners for transfer of equipment and sale of equipment to the Brazilian Navy. How did that impact on the kind of Brazilian industrial base? Because as we know, warships are complex to build, design, and support. Where did that kind of feature in terms of the shipbuilding capabilities of Brazil, and were they negatively impacted as a result?
Before World War II, Brazil had no capability of the building these modern warships. Brazil didn't have a steel plant, big steel plant in the country. Okay. The Second World War was saw a big advance in that, because Brazil not only developed this industry with American help, but built warships. However, the supply of cheap, available, and easy second-hand American warships made Brazil abandon this industry. From the 40s to the 70s, almost all the shipbuilding industry in Brazil was a civilian one, and very small in
that moment.
And more than worshipped, we were not in the capability of Brazilian in that day. The main idea of the, one of the key ideas of the program of the Senado, that was a 10-year plan to modernize Brazilian fleet, was create this capability in Beirut. And Brazil saw international importance in that. Was an important demand. That time, the Brazil successfully negotiated with Vosper to construct two freeways and pass the know-how. Option was just how to build the ship, not the systems within the ship. Because even now, Brazil has some difficulties in building all the systems. It depends also from the foreign sales. I think that was an important question. And the fall of the success of the British was mainly that moment because the British were not compromised to transfer advanced and much more advanced technology. Brazilians wanted in that moment a nuclear propulsion, missile technology, and most of the US and most of the Europeans were not really interested in giving that. But for special conditions of the German, West German arms market, they were more willing to that. For example, in the 1975, West Germany sell to Brazil nuclear reactors. And this was a major step to Brazil in its current nuclear capabilities. But I don't know if I'm really answering your
question. No, that was useful. Thank you.
Who really has a question?
Well, first I'd like to compliment you for your team. I think it has high relevance for the understanding of our historical process, the Brazilian Navy, and also on the history of our technological dependence. And as we are developing our partnership with you in Scotland, I would like to offer you our capabilities on these matters. In the Naval College, we have some professors that are specialized in history, naval history, and I put you in contact with him in the Center for Political and Strategic Studies. We have a professor that is exactly specialized on the things you are talking about. And also, we can offer you some theoretical basis on the transfer of technology debate. This is an ongoing debate that has some historical background. In your research, you are talking some parts of this debate. Technological dependence is a problem until now in Brazil. All those transfers, technological transfer, had an impact on our defense industrial base. And despite they were able to build some industrial capability, they would not develop a native technological capability on this defense industry, this kind of defense industry, because they are extremely intensive in science-based technology. Well, but this is a problem that we are trying to revert until today. So if you see our national strategy of defense, you see that it's now a condition, a precondition for procurement, the full technology transfer of the hypersonic. But one of the things that caught my attention was the time frame of your research. I had the impression that it's a wide time frame. Will you take care of all that time without leaving things aside or behind? That's my only question. Other than that, I like to offer that support if you have interest. And I think your research is very important for us. And I wish you success in this.
Thank you. I realize that it's a big pyramid. It's a big ambitious from my part to take care of that. But I try to control this by focusing in the British diplomat papers available here at the National Archives and the Brazilian ministerial reports. So it was mainly two documents, two kinds of documents that I will analyze. And fortunately for me, a big part of the literature about that time I have already because of my PhD research. So I expect to finish that. And it's my try.
Well, I do not put this question, but just things to think about. You know? In the beginning, you mentioned a difference between hegemony and opportunistic commercial approach. It would be interesting to see what you understand as this difference. No, you don't need to answer right now, it's just things to think about. So isn't that the opportunistic commercial approach a way also of assure a hegemony? No? And with that, automatically, when you transfer technology, you are not automatically framed some ways of thinking strategically, because, well, if you have the resources that came from one specific platform, how to apply these resources, changing completely this platform, or imagining in a different way. So it's just things, I actually don't have answers to, it's just really help to think about that. When you mentioned Viterói class, and that was possible to build that in Brazil too, I will put together what was his question. No? What that implied for Brazil, which changed that, I think was a quite important moment for our defense industry. And I think also would be interesting to see how many steps we move forward with especially that situation of the Niterói class frigate. And finally, we are talking always in a position of a reactive position. You know? So Brazil is receiving, it's people going there trying to sail, but what are the active positions of Brazil in this frame period too? Was not, Brazil was not also trying to sail all the time to other countries. So what that represent in our diplomacy? Which sort of change of balance of power if we had a old ship, I don't know, I'm just guessing again. If we had an old ship and we, as we recently did to some African countries, what sort of change that implies in sort of geopolitical balance? Is that not also a projection of a dependence on Brazilian industrial platform if you do that in some way? So I think instead of looking just one way going back no US Brazil or UK Brazil, if we put that in a more global context, what we can see there, and perhaps we move from that position of always talking about Brazil in a reactive position and not in an active position, because there are decisions that are being proactive and not only reactive. It's not only US going there to say shit, we also want to buy something. So there is some action behind that. It's just some comments to think about after, no? I don't want to bomb you more. And more questions from the audience? Yes?
And more of a point, don't take up too much time, but it's maybe worth looking at naval doctrine as well. So you have defense policy and procurement and building. How does that fit in with Brazilian naval doctrine? I mean, naval doctrine is the framework of what you do, why you do it, and how you do it. It'd be interesting to view or to see what exactly was Brazil doing doctrinally during those periods.
Before World War II, I think that Brazil didn't have a real clear doctrine. The main concern was Argentina. And basically, when Argentina bought warships, Brazil bought some to face them. When Brazil bought another warship, the Argentinians bought another. There were influence from, evidently, from the United States, from the UK, for example, Mann was important in this first moment, even as a justification for the Brazilian dreadnoughts. But in the post-war, in the Cold War, the doctrine of Brazilian naval was mainly anti-submarine warfare. Why? In the war, because the Germans attacked Brazil with submarines. And after the war, Brazil sided with the United States. This was a pattern, not just for Brazilian Navy, all Latin American navies, and many of the European navies as well became anti-submarine warfare. The problem to Brazil at that time was that, as in that time, a third world country, the problems to Brazil were not just the east and west confrontation. And doing in a framework, organizing the Navy and a framework of only anti-submarine warfare gave us some problems to Brazil. And I think that it's interesting to note that the changes in the foreign policy of Brazil to act more independent, more conscious about their interests, reflect in part in the Middle East. I don't know if I'm really answering that.
Well, I would suggest we get the time to get a coffee, some water, and just after that we move to the second presentation, okay? We have with us tonight one third-year PhD student from African Leadership Center, Ms. Nachio Kafori-Arud. She will present a part of her research on illegal unreported and unregulated fishing in the African coast. It's interesting because yesterday in one of the lectures we had, we were actually discussing in the Beirão presentation what are considered from the African countries' point of view the threats. And one of the main issues that he pointed out was the question of fishing too. So I think your presentation today will be a good dialogue with what we had yesterday. Thanks again for coming and joining us, and that's your floor.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ifes Machi, and I'm a PhD student from the African Leadership Center. My research leads at the human security implications of illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing. But not until I started analyzing my data did I find out that there is a possible correlation between illegal fishing and some of the sustainable development. Before I go into details of my presentation, I'd like you to have a look at this. And I'm hoping that at the end of my presentation, you would have somehow begin to understand why I chose this theme. Before I commence, I'd like to give a brief synopsis of what IUU fishing entails and the significance of fisheries for people in Nigeria, specifically, and then the Gulf of Guinea population. Fisheries is very, fisheries is significant for the populations of Nigeria, the Gulf of Guinea population as well, as it starts as food, income, and source of nutrition. At the same time, unsustainable fishing practices such as IUU fishing is very, very, very high. In the West African part of the Gulf of Guinea, for example, IUU fishing accounts for 40% more than the original catch, making the region the IUU fishing capital of the world. I mean, this is according to some of the reports from the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization. And the correlation between IUU fishing and fisheries and the sustainable development goals, of course, is the goal number 14, which talks about sustaining or conserving seas, marine, and ocean resources. So for my research, the contribution, well, the justification for my research, which looks at the human security implication of illegal fishing, therefore, is to contribute to the academic debate on the significance of fisheries as a source of food and income for Nigerians and the Gulf of Guinea at large. Due to the death of academic research that seeks to explore the threat of IUU fishing, for so long, researchers and policymakers have written so much about piracy and armed robbery at sea, as well as illegal oil bunkering in the region, whilst indirectly ignoring other threats, such as the IUU fishing. Hence, one of the motivations or the reason why I decided to undertake the research. And of course, another contribution is to contribute to the academic debate on human versus national security. Of course, human security is still very controversial. Some people feeling, or some scholars feeling, that there's no place for it in reality. Although it might make sense on a policy paper, that in reality it's just impractical. And finally, to contribute to the academic debate on state effectiveness, and in this case, ineffectiveness and securitization. The theoretical framework for my research is maritime and national security, well, the traditional ideas of security and human security. One of the reasons why I decided to tackle the maritime security threats in the Gulf of Guinea from the human security perspective is not because I feel that the traditional security ideas are no longer relevant. They are relevant, but because the threats actually affect the people more than the state, if that makes sense. And then their reaction to their own threats then affects the state. As a result, you cannot just talk about security by ignoring the human security rationale or the human security perspective in terms of maritime security threats. And of course, the state effectiveness or ineffectiveness argument in this case. For some scholars, most countries in sub-Saharan Africa might be better be described as failed or failing state. But I don't think that is the case for Nigeria, especially because although it has gotten a lot of things wrong, it is getting a lot of things right. As a result, I feel that the situation in the country is best described with the state effectiveness argument rather than the state failure argument. And of course, securitization, which again is a very controversial topic, whose critic have argued that it's irrelevant in this sense, because if you start securitizing everything, then where will you stop? But I'm hoping that by the end of this presentation, you'll begin to realize that unless something radically different, and in my research, I'm arguing securitizing IU fishing is done, not only are most of the countries in Gulf of Guinea not going to be able to attain some of the sustainable development goals, but the national security of Nigeria, for example, and by extension, some of the other countries in the Gulf of Guinea will be at risk. My research questions. The general research question is, do human security threats associated with IUU fishing pose a significant threat to the national security of countries in the Gulf of Guinea? Nigeria is a case study. And because within the human security concept, there are at least seven other components. I couldn't look at all of them, but I selected environmental, food, and economic security because the three of them are interlinked. For example, in the case of fisheries, without environmental security or without a healthy marine environment, the fisher folks would not catch enough to feed their family. That is, their economic security would be jeopardized. And without selling enough fish to feed their family, their food security will as well be affected. Hence the reason why I selected the three. And for my operational questions, the number one is, how does the fishing community define security? And this is bringing us to the humane aspect of security. How do they describe what happens to them? How do they quantify security, their own security? How do they react to trust their perception of security? Does such response affect or have any direct threat to the national security of Nigeria? And finally, does Nigerian government have the capacity to safeguard its maritime domain? I'm hoping that at the end of this presentation, I will have effectively answered this question. For my data collection, I went to Bonny in River State, one of the Niger Delta regions. My research entailed a focus group discussion and interview with fisher folks and fishmongers in four different fishing settlements offshore. And I proceeded to do some elite interview with chiefs of naval operations, director of naval operations, director of planning, and directors of the Nigerian Department of Fisheries, the Nigerian Trawler Owners Association, and the Nigerian Maritime Administration and Safety Agencies. I also was fortunate to participate in an EU-funded AU project as a resource person, and I was privileged to have access to some documents I wouldn't have ordinarily, so my data was also collected from that project. Now, in sort of explaining the correlation between IUU fishing and sustainable development goals and the human security aspect of it, one of the things I found in my data collection was that, and probably this is probably one of the reasons why there's not been enough research in the topic, lack of data. It was almost non-existent. I mean, you couldn't get any data. Okay, in trying to explain it, this could be because IUU fishing is an illegal thing, so you can't really find, there are no faces, so there's no way to document it. But one of the other reasons, or the probable reason for this, is also because of the lack of ineffective monitoring, control, and surveillance system in Nigeria, and unfortunately, across most of the countries in the Gulf of Guinea, so this has made it very difficult to document it. However, I'm trying to highlight the environmental security aspect of unsustainable fishing process, such as IUU fishing. I will illustrate or give an example with illegal or permissible fishing that is legal in the country. And yeah, this is 2004. That is as relevant or as recent as some of the data you can get. And this is only because the Nigerian Department of Fisheries had a research with the FAO, hence how this letter came about. This is looking at the legal catch by registered or licensed vessels in Nigeria. And this is from from January to December 2004. This is the legal amount, the amount of catch they made for shrimps. These are for licensed shrimping vessels. And this is the bycatches. Bycatches is, you know, it's more or less inevitable when you're fishing. You have to, sometimes depending on the equipment you use, there are juvenile fishes of maybe the species you're not looking for, but there's always a tendency that you're always going to get a bycatch. But this is just so much, almost three times four the amount of the legal catch. And these are likely going to be thrown back at sea. They are dead, they're going to pollute the marine environment, and they would inevitably deplete the marine environment. And this is the one we know because this is the legal, permissible catch. So then, get the picture in your mind, then what about the unaccounted ones? What about illegal fishing? That so far the Nigerian Department of Fisheries has not caught any vessel in the act, yet they know it occurs. So far the Nigerian Navy, yeah, they might have caught people, but because they don't understand the whole process, they've let them go or have not necessarily prosecuted them. So what about the bycatches that come from this? So at this stage, we don't even know the amount of fisheries we have left. We don't know what is already overexploited or how we can conserve what we have because we do not have the facilities. That's an effective MCS base to carry out this work. And then in looking at the economic aspect of things, you will find that for so many other reasons, which I will explain towards the end of my presentation, that registered commercial vessels are leaving Nigeria to go to other countries for security reasons, probably, and also because it's no longer healthy for them to operate in Nigeria. And this is, of course, affecting the economic situation in Nigeria in terms of the amount of money they get from the fisheries sector. In 2008, we had 250 fishing, shrimping commercial vessels registered to fish in Nigeria. As of 2016 March, we have 147. That is 103 reduction. As the time of making this presentation, we don't have any tuna exploiting vessel. Neither do we have any fishing partnership agreement with any distant water fishing nation. But these vessels still encroach Nigerian EEZ, exclusive economic zone to come and fish illegally. And then moving to the amount of money we make from shrimping. As of 2015, last year, we made 29 million from exporting our shrimps because our shrimps are very desirable globally, especially in Europe and America. But in contrast to 68 million that we made in 2008, evidently, I mean, for whatever reason, be it IUU fishing alone, be it pollution from the oil multinational, or be it the impact of climate change, something is going on. But because we do not have an effective MCS base, we're not able to deduce exactly what is going on, to what extent, and how much we have left to be able to begin to conserve what we have. And then looking at the food security implication, not only has the amount of catch the littoral communities are able to get to feed themselves and fend for their families reduced, but for the non-fishing communities, the price of fresh fish has increased drastically, which is making it almost non-affordable. Remember, fishery is not only important as food for many of the Gulf of Guinea population and Nigerian population, but is also a key or vital source of protein because it is very cheap. But now it's becoming very expensive and unaccessible. And as of yesterday, the Nigerian government was saying that we should prepare for a famine. I don't know if this is with respect to the North alone or the whole Nigeria, but this of course doesn't look good. in addition to the statement that was coming from the presidency. And then, in looking at the overall state of fisheries resources in Nigeria, there's a lack of investment in the region. And directly or indirectly, this is affecting or more or less fueling or encouraging IUU fishing. Because without any designated landing site, for example, it means that vessels can transship wherever and then land it wherever in Nigeria. Nobody will be there to meet them to account for what they brought in because we do not have a designated landing site. Lack of effective MCS base, like I said, untrained personnel. This might be laughable, but for me as a Nigerian, I didn't find it funny when I was told by an assistant director of fish trade that some of the officials just hand over license to vessels because they're scared of the sea. You know, they're meant to go in and go around with you to see how sustainable the equipment you have is. But some of them can't even get on the water because they are scared of water. Yet they are fishing officers. Why are they there? So untrained personnel is a big problem. Corrupt officials, and again, Nigeria, I don't want to say notorious, but they have been known to have been registering vessels that have been complacent in IUU fishing. The biggest story being the story of Tonda 2014-2015. Unfortunately, this continues to be the case. And what is the solution, you might ask? And lack of interest by the government. I use the term lack of interest because it came up repeatedly. Most of the people I interviewed were saying that the government is so fixated on oil that they've ignored every other sector, which might explain why we're currently not exploiting our tuna resources, but it's being taken by others every day via IUU fishing. This is the social reality and more or less explaining the ineffectiveness of the Nigerian state. I think at this point I have to say that to be identified or recognized as an effective state, you have to not only be able to protect your people, but also provide them with their basic needs. And this is Bonny. They produce, okay, let me just off my head, 60% of the oil that we export, the good oil that we export. But the social condition there is so appalling. Yet, in the same Bonny, the residents of the Nigerian natural liquefied gas is like heaven compared to this. So it's like two countries, one developed, one massively underdeveloped, in the same environment, and yet they are the people producing most of the things that you use. Then the big question of how then does the people that are affected by IUU fishing, how do they respond to it? You begin to see that as a human being, obviously you don't want to sit down and do nothing when you're not catching enough. You want to be able to feed your family. And unfortunately, some of these people then begin to resort to IUU fishing themselves. Fishing in areas has been restricted to them. Some of them begin to engage in illegal oil bunkering. Some of them begin to engage in armed robbery at sea or conniving with other armed robbers to rob fishing vessels. Some of them, especially fishmongers, go into prostitution because at the end of the day, you have to fend for yourself and your family. And in effect, alongside the economic, food, and environmental security implications of IUU fishing, both for those people and for Nigeria, the actions of these people then poses even greater national security threat for the Nigerian state. Hence the reason why I feel that my theory of justifying or defining maritime security from the human security perspective, but at the same time recognizing the role of the state in taking care of the people, is relevant. So, from the diagram, you would see that IUU fishing by commercial and foreign vessels have now or then resulted in IUU fishing by the fisher folks, and pipeline by the mobilization by some, them armed robbery at sea, prostitution, illegal migration or migration, and in the middle of food state ineffectiveness, because the Nigerian state are then proven to be ineffective in handling the interests of their people. And then coming back to how then does this, how relevant or what is the relationship between all these things to the sustainable development goals? Here, I just want to show you, keep in mind goal number one, goal number two, to some extent goal number three, for so many of them and millions of people in Nigeria and Gulf of Guinea, goal number four, goal number eight, which is good jobs and economic growth, and of course, life below water. It then therefore means that for so many of the reasons that I've stated already, it would be impossible for a country like Nigeria, and indeed most of the countries in the Gulf of Guinea, to be able to attain not all, but some of the SDGs, especially because of the prevalence of IUU fishing. There can't be any end to poverty by 2030. Neither can we meet goal number 14, that is marine conservation. Poor economic growth, we can't improve economic growth, which is goal number 8. Quality education, we can't get that because for so many of the fishing folks and people that live in the littoral communities, they cannot catch enough to feed their families so they can't go to school at the same time. End to poverty, we can't get that because fisheries serves a significant part of nutrition. So the good health aspect of SDGs is going to be a challenge for us to get. And no end to hunger, of course, fisheries serves as food. This is obviously my justification for the theme of the research. What then you might ask is the solution. I know this might be controversial, but I'm arguing that Buzan et al.'s securitization idea is a viable solution for now. Because in line with the argument, if something or a referent object, in this case, the Gulf of Guinea population, the Nigerian population, the marine environment is existentially threatened, then there has to be a radical action. And in line with the securitization argument, a speech act, someone in power or an elite recognizing that there's a problem and then taking an action to do something about it. Perhaps something similar to what they did with Somalia and in Nigeria with piracy and armed robbery at sea. But this is not a lasting solution, of course. This is a solution for now that would ensure that the fishing vessels are supported, the Navy are supported with the funds they need to support the worker, the fisheries sector, and of course, regional cooperation. We can't, due to the vast size of the Gulf of Guinea region, it will be almost impossible for any country to effectively manage their own maritime domain. As a result, there is a need for cooperation between the states. But first, before you can cooperate with one another, you have to have an effective system to manage activities in your own waters. And of course, international collaboration. In line with international collaboration, there is also the need for developed nations that provide fishing subsidies for their fishing sector to retain their action because a link has been identified between IUU fishing and fisheries subsidies. Conclusion. While the argument continues about the sustainability or suitability of human security in defining security or the invalidity of the securitization argument, my research found that IUU fishing threatens the human security and national security of Nigeria as fisheries play a significant role in the food and economic security of the country. Thank you so much for listening.
yesterday lectures on the aspects of what we consider security in the ocean actually has a lot of impacts on the land security too, and that your talk really brought us this perspective quite well. Thank you very much. I will open for, yes?
Very short presentation there. The course of the Brazilian student has started my PhD. Have you considered your study and evaluation, maybe possible relations? Your study, because I think in reality we are there between piracy and IUU problem, because maybe both are reflections of the cause that are happening there. And so the two big problems. How would you scale those two problems if they are connected? One in your perspective, Nigerian perspective, one more important than others to be tackled, for example?
First of all, before I answer the question, I'd like to say that the situation in Somalia whereby piracy, it has been argued a piracy, IUU fishing in the region was a direct response to, piracy in the region was a direct response to IUU fishing in the region, is not the same in Nigeria. This is, of course, the views of the naval officials that I interviewed and the senior directors of Nigerian Department of Fisheries. At the same time, I found that some of the fisher folks, that's fishermen, that have complained that they don't have any subsidies, yet fishing vessels come to fish the little they get, have resorted to armed robbery within Nigeria. And something that is very unique about this armed robbery and the people that fall victim to it are most times, at least 80% of the time, illegal fishing vessels. And according to the Nigerian Navy, the Nigerian Maritime and Safety Organization, and the Nigerian Fisheries Organization, they are not aware of the presence of such vessel until they are attacked by armed robbers, if that makes sense. So, the vessels have only been attacked because they are where they are not supposed to be. So, does that make sense? They're probably engaging in illegal fishing. That's why they've been attacked. For example, a vessel is meant to be operating in this area, and then there's been news of armed robbery attack in this area. So they're only there because they're doing something they shouldn't be doing, be it engaging in illegal fishing or anything else. So their standpoint is that it's always possible that illegal fishing, commercial vessels have fallen victim to armed robbery at sea because they're engaging in that act. But I have to say that most of the fisher folks that I interviewed, at least three of them that was willing to talk to me, two said they have engaged in robbery just to support their income because they were not getting enough. One said that they have acted as lookout and they have to do this because they don't get any funds support. So I don't know if there might be then a link to piracy, because then you're talking about going beyond Nigeria border to another country. But none of the people I interviewed have ever engaged in piracy, but I'm not very serious.
I was wondering if the EU is very concerned with IUU in Thailand, where it's a huge problem as well, and have some programs and supporting some programs. Is the EU involved in Nigeria with this issue?
Not currently in Nigeria, but they are involved in many countries in the Gulf of Guinea. Okay. And unfortunately, the EU is complicit in more or less encouraging IUU fishing thanks to their fisheries subsidies. Because the vessels, the license, are able to encroach. Again, like I said, most of these countries do not have an effective MCS-based monitoring control and surveillance. So they're not able to monitor whether or not the vessels that are coming in sticking to the terms of the agreement. And there's been lots of examples of encroachment, for example, with a country that has an agreement with maybe a distant water fishing nation like the EU, any other countries in the EU, Russia or China encroaching into Nigerian waters to fish wild tuna, even though we don't have any tuna agreement currently. So that's why I mentioned that there is need for the blue countries that provide fishing subsidies for their countries to sort of look at how that might be affected, how that might be reversed. The World Trade Center, the World Trade Organization, sorry, recognizes that fishery subsidies play a key role in Nigerian fishing as well.
They are
currently doing something about it. They are currently working with countries. They have this flagging countries that have increasingly been identified as flagging nations that are complacent for IUU fishing. Like currently, Guinea has a red flag, which means the EU cannot deal with them and they cannot export their fisheries to the EU. Ghana had a yellow flag, but they have sort of worked on their fisheries regulations and are continuing to improve.
Sorry, US AFRICOM run two exercises in the Gulf of Guinea each year. Exercise Saharan Express in Senegalese waters typically, and Obangami Express, which will either be Nigeria, possibly Cameroon or Gabon. The aim of these exercises is to train and test local navies and coast guards, a large part of which is anti-IUU fishing. Most importantly of all, it's testing the MOCs, the Maritime Operating Centres. It is possible to track a ship from Senegal's Senegalese MOC to the MOC in Angola, underlining the fact that integrated, coordinated approaches are required to stop any illegal activity at sea. Why do you think that this integrated, coordinated approach isn't being followed, even though the infrastructure is in place?
The infrastructure is in place. It depends on to what extent. Like my meeting with the naval officials, they have been playing the role of fisheries enforcers, because we don't have Nigerian Department of Fisheries does not have a patrol vessel, so that's left to the Navy to do. They've been doing the work of border security as well as trying to stop pipeline mobilization and protecting our marine installations. The problem is that they are very underfunded. So there's a limit. As much as they would want to do more, they're very trained. Our Navy are very trained. And in comparison to the rest of the countries in Gulf of Guinea, our fleets are quite sophisticated. But the problem is lack of fund, fueling the vessels. Some of the vessels are so old that they can't actually engage in pursuit. So it's one thing to see someone engaging in an act, but then be able to engage in pursuit, we are limited in that aspect. So I understand, yeah, there are so many projects, there are a lot of them currently, but the sustainability is a problem. And that is the reason why I talk about securitization, because when the government is committed, they're not only going to follow their commitment with taking action, but that will be followed by funding. I don't know if you're aware of this, but in 2008-2009, the Gulf of Guinea Commission was set up by so many countries in the region. On paper, yes, it looks very good, but to date, most of the countries have not even paid their dues. Their office is just there. They've been talking about getting a coordination center since 2014, and I was due to go there for my research. It's still not in place because the commitment has not been followed by money. And unfortunately, without money...
Is this a center in Yaoundé?
Yes. I don't know if that answers.
Yes, very good. Thank you.
More questions?
Sort of your answer led me to a bit of another question. Also, I mean, if you have countries with high levels of corruption and maybe like a very not with very not very responsive governments. What is the difference in terms of, in practical terms, between having your government just sell the rights to the fisheries in the countries, and IUU fishing, maybe by local populations or international vessels or vessels from the EU? I don't know if I'm making myself clear. I mean, in practical terms, how important is either or how and how much difference does it actually make to register and regulate if the governments that do this registration and this regulation are not really responsive and maybe don't even have data on how on the fisheries and are not responsive to the needs of their populations.
You're right, but that is why we're now talking about making them understand that IUU fishing is a big deal. No longer should they continue to ignore the fishery sector, for example. I mean, if you see what's happening with the oil and the Nigerian economy, I'm hoping that they are waking up to that reality that they can no longer be fixated with oil, but there are other things. And if they do nothing, then I'm sure maybe by 2030 there will be another SDG 2060, because so many countries, unfortunately, because of the critical thing, so many countries in the region will not get this. And what you find is that things will even get worse, because the traditional fishermen, and according to the last data, 2006, about 1 million and 24 million depending directly on fisheries as of 2008 as a source of food and nutrition in Nigeria. That's a lot of number for the government to ignore. They can no longer continue to ignore. And I'm hoping that obviously my research will be one angle to so many other research that will follow, or ongoing ones that would more or less make them realize that they need to do something. Yes, having agreements with distant fishing nations is very good, but you can ensure the sustainability of such agreements. In 10 years' time, those nations will be looking elsewhere because you will not have enough resources to give to them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, President Chief. It was very, very good, and I think brought a very good perspective for the conference in general. We'll move to the next one. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like, first of all, thanks to the opportunity to talk about the beginning of my research, just in the beginning. Thank you for Ludolf, which gave me a good first approach, historically speaking, because my time frame starts in the mid-80s. We'll talk about that. And secondly, I'd like to apologize for my low quality English. I'm working on that already, so I try to make use of that. It will be a very simple presentation because, as I said, I'm just the beginning of my research. I have my research project. I have my two supervisors here. I thank you for that. Denise with us, and also Carlos from Water Studies the second. And I'm trying to develop from my research projects, and I will give some points of that research to give you an idea what I'm going to research. So that's the initial title. It can change, of course, but I'm researching about the Brazilian naval strategic thinking evolution under the concept of power. I will talk about that. I'll try to like Ribeiro said yesterday, like the Jack Stripper. I try to divide some class of words to talk about them and make a better idea of what I'm going to study and research. Well, this slide gives us an idea of the very simple idea. It comes from the agro presentation. I took it again from there, of the huge assignments Brazil Native has in, as a very important instrument of the Brazilian states. I will talk about that later, but just to tell you, we have an outgoing engagement and an ingoing engagement. So the two sides of the slide give us that idea. With international engagement, the outgoing, for example, and the subsidiary assignments inside of Brazil. Well, I follow this outline, some introduction. When you talk about Brazilian naval strategic thinking, we for sure have to touch on some authors in Brazilian Navy, some very important authors, historians. For example, I would like to cite Admiral Vidigal. It's a very important thinker in Brazil when we talk about Brazilian thinking, naval strategic thinking. And he served as an inspiration for me to go beyond that and try to make some deeper thoughts about this theme. So, in this introduction, I'd like to highlight my time framework. I'll try to get from mid-80s to 2010. Why that? Because I think this period gives us a very good idea of the changing features of in many aspects, domestic aspects, international aspects. Well, internationally speaking, we have the end of the Cold War, we have a special mindset towards the Cold War, the bipolarity, and internally, we were ending a military government in the 80s, and then we started the democratization of Brazil, and it gave us a lot of important facts to look at. One of them was, for example, the establishment, the creation of the Ministry of Defense in 1999. Before that, the three services were ministries themselves. So it was a huge change that still are having effect nowadays, because as we all know, so institutional change, they take time to get to really get established and the desired effects in, for example, in the creation of the Ministry of Defense. We had also, justificating my time frame, 2010, because 2010 encompasses the first established national strategy of defense. 2008 was the first explicit, mainly speaking, strategy document. So it had a lot of impact in the Brazilian naval thinking to the end of that period. And also, that's the part of my strategic naval strategic thinking in the title. The second part, concepts of power. Well, I try to base mainly on the a concept that an author, very well known author, Joseph Nye, gave us about concepts of soft and hard power. Of course, the context is different. The context is the context of mainly United States. Its position in the world. And Nye talked about that, trying to give us a different perspective of power. When he tries to convene the idea of the increasing importance of soft power for the American foreign policy. And well, why I use this concept of power, or I try to establish some dialogue with them. Because when we talk about power, we talk about influence. We just want to make some influence over some actors. Talking about actors, we are, in the case of Brazil, as an international actor, of course. But we have very different means, very distinctive means. So maybe you try to use this concept with an actor in a very different position from the United States. Maybe you have some things different to say about that, about this concept. And that's the main idea of my project, the starting idea. Of course, we are not going to focus only on this concept, because in the Brazilian case, as we are a very unique type of name, because we don't have only the international engagement activities. We have, as I said, and as discussed a little bit before, we have some internal assignments, and it plays a lot of plays so much of a role in our overall activities and efforts as well. That's my introduction. I would say that when I said the two main postures, outbound and inbound, I would say that outbound, I would highlight two main aspects of the latest international engagement. Cooperation, we heard about a lot of this point, cooperation. Besides that, the international engagement in peacekeeping operations, for example. And apart from those two points, international engagement, the preparedness for defense. And then it comes the concept of the Blue Amazon, so important for us. By the way, today in Brazil is a national day of the Blue Amazon. It's established by law. It's a kind of a Brazilian effort to highlight the importance of the sea and the importance for the Brazilian state to pay attention to the sea in a security aspect as well. Of course, it's the question, the matter of the resources, the protecting of the resources. We may say, yes, the first gentleman on the beginning of the conference there in Canning House, when he said, who are the Brazil enemy? Well, it's difficult to, in the case of armed force and defense, more particularly in the case of Brazil, establish a rare, very real enemy in the horizontal, So it's maybe from a North perspective, it's much easier because you have the countries in the North Hemisphere have more engagement throughout the world. Some wars that's still happening. In the Brazil case, in the geopolitical position of Brazil and the historic past of Brazil, we could see in the case of Lula's presentation, we have very little engagement outside in terms of wars and, well, some participation in First World War, Second World War, but always subordinated to the allies in those wars. We have the case, as stated by Admiral Rocha in the 60s, with a crisis with France in the North East of Brazil because of the lobster, called in Brazil the Lobster War. But in the sense of a very imminent enemy, we really don't have that. So it plays a lot in our thinking, in our mindsets. In that case, it's difficult already to make it harder to make people, society, understand the importance of thinking ahead. Because even if you don't have a very visible enemy, well, but at the same time, Oh, history tells us about that. We don't, we have to be prepared for it. And especially in the case of countries like Brazil, we don't have, like many said before, we don't have a very strong defense industry. We take a lot of time to get ready to go through the process of trying to design, to establish all the settings and the platforms and the training and to be prepared for defense. So we have really to think in advance in this case. So in this outbound perspective, I talked about defense preparedness related to the narrative mainly of the Blue Amazon. Not only that, we go beyond that of course, but mainly this. And the participation in peacekeeping operations, maritime task force, as we are having the command right now, in cooperation. In the inside perspective, the inbound perspective, we have a very strong role in the maritime authority in Brazil. And beside that, the state building, giving support, as stated before, to the riverine people, mainly in the Amazon and Pantanal Basin. It has a traditional role in this kind of support, in this kind of activity. That's why they call the ships in name that work there as hope ships, I should say. And well, those are the main aspects of the evidence I'm going to search for. But and try to relate mainly in the case of external engagement, the concept, try to engage the concept of power. But when you try about, when you try to lift some concepts, it's not only about concepts of power. I will try to use as well some concepts as, for example, deterrence, yeah, which is related to defense preparedness, of course, and about regional security complex. That's when said about Busan, the securitization. It's a concept that I believe will help a lot to interpret, to give us an interpretation of the Brazilian posture since the end of the 80s to now. Because with the end of the Cold War, with the bipolarity, we have struggled to strengthen the South American engagement with our partners and by means of cooperation in defense. Actually, it came even before the 80s. For example, the Argentina Navy have exercises since the 70s, for example. And in this regional approach, now we try to extrapolate South America, going to the Africa, to cooperate with our partners in Africa, in the West Africa coast. So I try also to highlight those other concepts. Well, I in terms of research questions, I'd like to highlight. That trying to map this evolution from the 80s to 2010, about I will try to offer a different interpretation. We always talk about Brazil being an object of research, but in this type of research, being a practitioner, a Brazilian practitioner in the area. At this point, I want to highlight, as Mr. Peter Roberts told us yesterday, he is a kind of scholar and practitioner. That I'm trying to take the most of this position as well, because I have the scholar experience a little and the practitioner, because being a major officer, I try to highlight this and try to use the most, the best of the two aspects. I will try to present the Brazilian perspective as a subject, and not only as an object. And in this kind of intention, I will try to dialogue with these concepts to try to offer some different views about them. As Alfred Lacan Nye states, power is a very contextual concept, depends much on the context. So our context is very different from the North perspective context. So I'll try to highlight this context with this internal transformation. Brazil, as I said, the legal framework started with the Constitution of 1988 and some other infraconstitutional laws that became that came after that, since the top 2000 years, and then it gave us a lot of internal assignments. One of them I was already acting, playing those roles. Other ones were new, and we have, in this sense, as I said, a both perspective. When I talk about methodology, well, trying to sum up the research questions, I try to give you an idea. Well, that would be like how has the evolution of the Brazilian naval strategic thinking been characterized since the end of the 80s to the end of the Lula administration in 2010, having as parents the concepts of soft power, hard power, and other concepts, as I said before, deterrence and security and regional security complex, for example. And this would be the main lines of the research question. Of course, after that I will have much more secondary questions. And I would like to take some approach on the methodology. Well, I try to, in terms of the methodology, I will try to, a part of researching in those concepts, and I will search for evidence in the Brazilian case, with also with some interviews of some naval authorities or former naval authorities, to try to grasp from their response some kind of clue about the decision making process that made the distinctions of the activities Brazilian Navy has taken through this time frame. I would like to try also to consult some archives, of course, in Brazilian Naval Archaeology, Brazilian archives, naval archives as well, and here, of course, here in London, with its many libraries and sources. And I think after that, in the case of the collection, data collection and analysis, I try to highlight the importance, how those evidence will be related. How is mainly in the aspects of decision making process. Yeah, because when we talk about strategic thinking, we have to try to understand what are the measures, what are the modifications in the existing configuration of the Navy and its activities, of course, as well, and how it plays a role. It gives an idea as strategic thinking modification. No, just to give an idea of relevance. Well, I should point that two perspectives of the relevance, one for the scholars and one for the practitioner. I should say that in the scholar perspective, the contribution would be mostly for having this point, as I said, the Brazilian naval strategic evolution, not only as an outsider view, but as a subject to dialogue with the, those theoretical concepts I told you. And I think this would enrich all the studies relating and taking focus on the Brazilian naval posture. In the case of practitioner, I would say that this kind of research, I think this strengthens our capacity to have a good self-image of ourselves. When we try to understand our reality, our identity, I think we have a better qualification to see this evolution in a line of tendency and try to figure out how would be the future, how would be that line in the future, how measures, how kinds of decision making process we would like to take to give a Brazil a better understanding of its position in the case of naval serving as an instrument, and how we should present ourselves, how we could make some different perspectives for the future. Well, with that, I'd like to finish and thank you all for your patience. Thank you very much.
How some circumstances in the context may have
influence on those decisions. That's why I talk about some fabric happening. And of course, when you talk about the end of the Cold War, we had already at that moment a configuration that didn't change like that. So I try to establish, as you suggest, thank you very much for your stressing that, trying to find some indicators to have them as a real indicator of strategic thinking, of change of that thinking. Well, in terms of cultural change, it's a more challenge in a sense that we are in a period, it's a very recent period. It's the ever-growing challenge when we face searching in the recent times, in the more past times. I try to take some advantage of being recent, because when we have recent times research, we tend to feel better the details of those transitions in this period. When you go more to the past, we may lose some important facts that happened at that time, and maybe during the passing time, we lose the capacity to grasp some details. I try to find a balance between both. And of course, this change, as you mentioned, about some cultural changes, it is still ongoing. It's still on the way. So it's, in that sense, it's difficult to try to measure maybe this kind of change. But I try to do that. Thank you very much.
You talk about strategic thinking, and one thing that occurs to me, to what extent, you know, does the Navy need to sell, you know, this strategic thinking parliament so that it can vote all the, you know, the credits for the project of the Blue Amazon for a Navy capable of defending Blue Amazon and also conducting diplomacy around the South Atlantic. I mean, how to what extent this naval thinking, strategic thinking, can be made public.
Mm-hmm. Well,
I mean, it's important for the parliament to be aware of or part of it.
Yeah, of course, it's a big concern of mine. I have to have the ability to do that in a reasonable measure, because when we talk about having the first, for example, national strategy of defense. Well, I think we, in terms of some aspects, not all of them, but in some aspects, for example, we can start from that. When you go to the past, when we didn't have a document, of course, you can try to grasp some political objectives. Naval policy, you can interpret the facts and try to highlight, to define what are the real the naval strategy in a very good measure, I would say. And then in the period, this first period, I try to highlight with some data which is available, it's open for everyone, and try to establish a line of reasoning in analyzing these patterns. I think when you say to what extent the strategic thinking to become public, well, this is one of, I would say, of the advantage of have these both perspectives as a scholar and as a practitioner, because we can try to have these both lenses. I would say I can maybe have better judgment to what extent I should go. Thank you. I don't know if I say how I'm going after you.
Well, congratulations for your research. I've just comments, not questions. And some of them are rockets. You rocks you have to pay attention in your way. First, your time frame. You said maybe the mid-80s to 2010. Well, 85, 86, 84, 87, you don't have any changes in this period. But after our constitution, 88, 89, 90, with the Cold War ending, yes, you have. So I think you could forget 85, 86, and begin with the constitution and Cold War from. And at the end, you've ended in 2010. In 2010, you have just the first one, naval strategy. 2012, you have the first review of that. And when you have the first edition, normally you have to think about it, and the second edition is better to be analyzed than the first one. So I would suggest you to go to the second edition. And I'll tell you why. Because at the second edition, Brazil changed the primary strategic area, including Antarctica, for example. So you will have other things to think about it.
And also the defense by HP.
Yes, 2012, the white defense white paper too. So I suggest you to go. But I'm suggesting you to come near us. And please be careful with the underway history.
Yeah.
Interviews, we are talking about memories, not history. So interviews are so dangerous. The relevant persons are still there, so be careful with that. And the second thing is to analyze the Brazilian Navy strategic. I agree with him. Navy or naval strategic thinking. You have to face with somebody. Probably they will talk to you, but I think Joseph Nye power conception maybe improved with Colin Gray, Geoffrey Till, some other naval strategic thinkers. Joseph.
Thank you very much, Theron, for your comments. The time frame, the first point. I'm not really highly concerned about the time frame, the beginning of this, mainly because of, well, when we talk about time frame, I'm worried about the context, the time context. Because when we talk about the 80s, I'm concerned about what happened before. Because they will act as an enabler, the fact we will act as enablers, as some unprecedented conditions for what happened after that. So, well, I think it's worth, I know, there comes a time when you have to fix a specific time here. And the second one, I think it's more relevant to do with what you said when we talk about grasping the second version of the national strategy of defense. It's, I think it's a very, and the white paper as well, because I have one more instrument of source and that gives us some ideas of how the people come to that document.
And it comes from the society, not just from the military power.
Yeah, we can discuss a lot about that. But, and have a lot of actors inside contributing to that other document. It's very important to maybe to just a little beyond the, because I established 2010 because of the end of the second mandate of Lula president. Maybe it's not a good point. Maybe it's just not important point to make. And I appreciate your comment on that. And about interviews, well, of course, when we can contest the using this kind of concept, of course, when you talk about time, because why would you say like well, Brazil is part of Brazil state. What about foreign policy? Not only Navy policy. And when you have try to influence, Navy would not maybe not influence by itself or the actors. Yes, it's a very fair point, I would say. But we have to struggle with that too, because Brazilian Navy acting maybe sometimes more than foreign policy office in some cases, like Nigeria, for example, Namibia, for example. And then what kind of, I try to find some balance. Maybe intervene some officials from the foreign policy office as well to try to make a better assessment of this, not only the immediate borders of the Navy activities. And well, I try to get thank you very much for this very, very important suggestion about the being careful about the interviews. And well, Navy, naval. Well, I'd like to give the question. What do you mean when you say difference between Navy and naval? What do you mean exactly? If you don't mind, if I give you the question.
I was just suggesting to make clear if there is any difference, because most of we generally thing on this subject is Brazilian Navy thing.
Okay.
But I don't know if there is some trick in the translation of the words, but if you're talking Brazilian naval strategic thinking, yes, it should be more than only the Navy.
So would you want to
yes,
to study the maritime strategic or just the power.
Yeah.
Let's think the naval versus Navy for a moment.
Okay.
Much time maybe comes up.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
That is also in the list.
Sorry, my question was on Namibia, if I may. I believe that relationship between Brazilian Navy and Namibia, the Namibian Navy began in 1994. How important has that been to the development of Brazilian naval strategic thinking, and what has the Brazilian Navy learned from it?
Well, I think when the specific case of Brazilian Navy and Namibia relationship, I think it goes direct to the cooperation points. When I try to categorize, firstly, internal, external, in the realms of external, defense preparedness, well, the main concept I would state as underpin this approach is the Blue Amazon concept, maybe. And in the other two, the international engagement, cooperation and peacekeeping operations, for example. In the cooperation realm, we have a lot of agreements with bilateral agreements, and directly related with foreign policy, Brazilian foreign policy, with African states, and Namibia comes as a very good example for that. Well, this, I think, if I really got your answer, I would say that it's very important for us as a good example of cooperation. And as I think Mr. William Moreno said before yesterday, in a more horizontal relationship, trying to help them and try to, well, our interest in projection through cooperation to the West African, not projection to impose our interests, for example, but try to find some common ground in terms of interests. How to we can by synergically, if I may say that, how to get advantage of some kind of relationship. And I think Namibia, it's a very good example of that. I don't know if I got it right.
Before very much. I move to Rina, just to make some remarks also. The question of Brazil and Namibia, I think, is an excellent example of a subject position in building up, I would not call the word model, but at least an approach to defense diplomacy. And I think Brazil found a good way of establishing a parameter of defense diplomacy from a south relation, from Brazil and Namibia, based on many traditional and scholarly oriented defense diplomacy principles, but taking into consideration the both realities. And in this point, I come into the side of José Cláudio, no? To say how for us it's important this idea of thinking Brazil from a subjective point of view and not objective one, and I reinforce what he said here. So as a research like his and studies like Brazilian and Namibian navies, I think they can show that we are not only in a position of consuming some theoretical constructions, but also trying to frame more precisely the way that we project our power. And this is the point José Cláudio's dissertation proposal has a very, very interesting, important point here. It's how we can build up some platform that we are projecting, syntactically speaking, a subject and not only being object of analysis of theories. So this is, I think, the biggest frame we have here. So from the 80s, we start to take a different approach. That's perhaps some moment there. It's so not so easy to precise this one point. We have, for example, in 85, these discussions with Argentina related to nuclear development in Brazil that precede the constitution, but they are also already defining some very consequence for a strategic growth, both militarily and civilian too. And in the point of view of a naval development, it's established a strong way of defining a long run defense thoughts. So I think this is an interesting period because it's not so well clear that, well, that was the constitution. It is a context. It is a context that in which also it's included the end of the Cold War. But I think it's a very interesting period to see and to Brazil to start to ask itself, well, what we need to do as a strategy now? How we will insert in a multipolar world that it's showing off now, how we will insert as a voice that can be, syntactically speaking, subjective. And the naval relation with Namibia, I think, is a good example of that. You know, that's a a voice that is not defined by previous models of defense diplomacy, but was based on the practice of it that we build up this. And now we can talk like model. Now, when we start, we are probably not talking about model, but now we are talking about model. No? So I think this is the main aspect that the Claudio the PhD dissertation will bring to us also. And remembering, coming back to the first, I think coming back to the Admiral's Russia, perception is also a different navy in many aspects. So to think about a naval strategy, we need to take into consideration that it's a very particular navy that needs to deal with the fantastic Amazon basin, the Pantanal basin, the large ocean we have ahead of us, and the relation with the neighbors, and the social integration in this navy with the society too. So that's an interesting point. No, it's not a strategy of the navy, but it's another strategy that needs to deal with a navy that's not a regular navy, considering or comparing to other navies in the world. And that's, I think, a very, very important point that you have here. No? Sorry, I just made another lecture. No?
Thank you.
For look the palette, this was me. No,
I just want to remember retaking the question of the time frame that we are having right now, the second revision of our strategic document. And I realized that your research will go through until maybe 2019, right?
Sorry?
Yeah.
2019.
The third version?
Your dissertation. Your dissertation will be
Yeah.
2010.
Yeah.
The dissertation will end by 2019,
right?
And then you have a new set of documents, something for you to evaluate the impact that it may cause. But I think there will be some change in the present ongoing revision. And also related to the beginning of the subject of the time frame, as we mentioned, there are some interesting events related to the nuclear program. I don't remember exactly when Sarney announced the, I think it's 1987.
The signature was 18.
No, the announcement of the domain of the enrichment process, public announcement, is a major event related to the strategic planning of the Navy, related to the nuclear propulsion.
Yes.
Summary.
Thank you.
Just some. More insight for
you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, I think we are arriving to the end of our not only session today, but also the conference. And again, it's quite clear that we had in these 3 days interesting and complex overview of South Atlantic Ocean defense or security perspective that goes beyond the traditional actors that we are seeing in this in thinking about security, bringing the Brazilian view, African's view, mixing that with UK and European views, helped us a lot to understand how suddenly we can also shift or move this globe and see the South Atlantic as a quite central space for strategic, for development, for governance, for leadership in the forthcoming years. And that's I think, the main goal of our conference that we could address. And I'm very glad to this result of this conference. Again, I just want to remember that this conference was something that was made by or organized by Brazil Institute in cooperation with Defense Studies, War Studies Department here, African Leadership Center, the RUSI, Cunning House, and Naval War College and Brazilian Navy. So it's a good example of how collaborating and put together the efforts we have, we can make an important and meaningful academic event that's discussing important realities and not only speculative aspects of it. I would like also again to thank the Brazilian Embassy for the support we got from the Brazilian Navy and the Brazil Naval and Defense Attaché here in London that is with us today here too, that helped a lot to make possible this event. I would like to thank the participation of all of you in the event, those who came to the lectures, those who did some presentation. I'd like to thank Pedro that was recording everything in these days so we can have the conference document well documented and available for everybody that could not be here. My master's students that came and talked every day in every class section they were here, and the three that organized the event together, no, Christoph, Ludolf and José Claudio, that were part of the team that put together this event here. Now, this is the second one that we are doing. The last one was last year. This is the second one. We are already thinking for next year what will be the points that we could bring together again and try to make, as I said, some change in the perceptions and the understanding of security issues in which Brazil and other actors will be involved, not only as an observer study. No? So thank you very much, William. You want to say something?
Okay, just a few words as you make ours your work. And thank you again, emphasize our thanks in the name of the Brazilian Naval War College and the Center for Political and Strategic Studies. It's a very important event in our partnership, one step forward, and we are looking forward to keep this partnership growing, and we have some plans for next year. I would like also to thank our Brazilian Navy Attaché, Captain Brigitte, for the support, very important support that he gives to us. And just to say to the PhD candidates that we are ready to collaborate with them if they need some reference, some insights, some bibliography from there, or some advice for our professors and specialists in some of the areas. And thank you and the Brazilian Institute. The Brazil Institute of the King's College once more. Thank you very much.
Thank you.